Once again, and if anything, in even more spectacular circumstances than at the Battle of Cape Matapan, naval aircraft of the fleet Aeron have had the chance of fulfilling the function for which they are mainly intended. That is, to find and shadow the enemy with long-range reconnaissance aircraft, and then to attack with an air striking force so as to reduce the enemy's speed and allow our surface craft to join action and finish off the job. This is their principal function in war. Aircraft torpedoes were never expected to sink battleships. They're not big enough for that. But they are expected to flood compartments, damage rudders and propellers, and so reduce the enemy's speed. In this particular action, outlying cruisers first discovered the enemy. But later, when touch had been lost, it was the naval aircraft which once more regained that vital contact. And as soon as they were within range, the air striking force got busy. Altogether, three different attacks were made, while two attempts failed owing to failure to make contact and the poor visibility. How my heart goes out to the leaders and pilots of those squadrons as they searched the seas and failed to find them, their petrol running lower and lower until they were forced to return. You know, I can so sympathize with them, because even in peacetime exercises, when one's head should have been far cooler than theirs, I've so often failed to find the target myself. Even then, it was an unpleasant enough feeling. But what they must have gone through, the chance they've been longing for within their grasp at last, just doesn't bear thinking about. Perhaps, however, those same leaders and pilots took part in the successful attacks. I do hope so for their sakes, because what greater moment can there be for a fleet Aeron pilot than the first sight of the enemy down below? Whether you are above the clouds and suddenly see them through a gap, or whether the sky is clear and you are approaching from upsun, there's just the same thrill. There they are, looking very small and harmless from that distance and height, just as the sea, though there are probably vicious waves to be found lower down, looks smooth and hospitable from right up top. It's probably the leader who sees them first, or it may be an air gunner in one of the rear machines. The odds are that it isn't one of the other pilots. They're far too busy keeping close formation on their leader. But whoever it is, he suddenly points wildly downwards and beats the sides of his machine with delight. All pilots forget formation for a moment and snatch a quick glance. There are grins as thumbs are held up. The air gunners grasp their guns. And the pilots, raising themselves against their harness, settle themselves again in their seats to be in the most comfortable position for the attack. As they approach the target, a hand signal from the leader orders the squadron to deploy. By now, the first of the long-range anti-aircraft fire is coming up, but this means nothing. The feeling of superiority as you look down on the target ship is terrific. She hasn't got a hope. Compared to our speed, she looks as though she's hardly moving, but the size of the wake tells the expert almost exactly to a knot. And although that speed may not be much in comparison with that of the aircraft, it's considerable in relation to that of the torpedo after it has been dropped. That's always the beginner's trouble. You know, he gets carried away with his own feeling of speed during the dive, aims only just ahead, and then, in those agonizing moments while the torpedo runs through the water, sees a ship move out of harm's way and his fish miss astern. Well, all right. By now we're right over her, and the leader with a yell of, "Down we go," gives a signal. Now it's every man for himself. But of course, according to a prearranged plan of attack. Obviously, we can't all fire from one angle, or she will be able to turn towards or away and present the minimum target when the fish cross her. Some of us will have to sacrifice our torpedoes so as to make her take avoiding action and give the others a beam target. It all depends now on what tactics she employs. And now as we go racing down, the wires whistling, the stick hard up against the dash, every pilot has his eyes on her stern. There's a sudden, but a very small swirl of water. Only the expert will see it. But it's enough to tell us that the helm has gone over and the rudder is moving. It will also tell the expert which way she's going to alter course. And yet after that, it's quite a number of seconds before the rudder gets a grip, and that grip can force 35,000 tons at full speed out of her present line of advance. Then, as she starts to heel over and swing to the helm, we can all get a pretty shrewd guess as to who will be the lucky ones with the beam target. You see, she's committed by now. We're at 3,000 feet, and you'll never have time to steady up and swing the other way. By now, every gun in the ship is blazing upwards, but that glorious feeling of headlong downward speed with a belly full of high explosive underneath you doesn't give you much chance of pausing to reflect. 2,000 feet. 1,000. Now's the time to turn in for the final approach. As you bank round, you see her for the first time from almost her own level. She's beginning to look much bigger and impressive now as her bow wave reaches up over her forecastle. As we flatten out of the turn, we're committed too to the line of fire. Violent kicks on the rudder and skid turns are all we can do to adjust the final aim. And then a moment later, pull the toggle and let the fish go. A rapid turn away, violent avoiding action, and in a few minutes we're out of harm's way and gaining height. The other pilots are doing the same. And as you look over your shoulder, you see the telltale tracks approaching the target. She's at full helm now and heeling right over. She'll avoid some, of course, but there are two she can't. There they go. And then suddenly two blinding flashes, one amidships, one right aft. And then what seems an endless journey back to the carrier until you can all get together and swap notes. That night, it's a special toast in the wardroom for the one whose torpedoes have hit. But it was the teamwork and the perfect training of the whole squadron which did the trick.